Should you have a nice idea?
Where are you from, Supriya?
I'm from Vancouver.
Okay.
I came to Canada about, in 1980, and I'm involved with the Bengali Cultural Society here. I've been running in Bangla school for the last 28 years. I'm very happy to talk about my
people.
First, I'd like to thank you, Habiba, for organizing this great conference. My presentation is about 31 men and 28 women who are Bengali immigrants from India. This is approximately 62% of Bengali women who attend the two cultural social societies that we have in Lower Mainland and who have lived here for more than 10 years. My presentation is solely based on rural varieties. I have not checked census or immigration records. So, fun fact, we sometimes ask ourselves, Bengalis ask ourselves, who was the first Bengali to set foot on this land? I'm not sure whether it was Swami Vivekananda, but he was a Hindu monk. He was going to attend the Parliament of Religion in Chicago, and he spent about 15 hours in that room. And then, although I knew about Taroknath Dash and his Gadar movement involvement in California, I did not realize, thank you, Tanya, that he may have been here. But we think that it was Tagore who was here in 1929 to attend the Triennial International Conference. This was not the first time that he was invited to come to Canada, but he had turned down previous invitations in protest to Kumaratta Maru incident. While in Vancouver, Tagore went to the Sikh temple and met with community leaders. Neither Vivekananda nor Tagore made Canada their home, but it is wonderful that this community Bengali were here, among the first ones to be here. Once again, this is oral narrative, but we believe that after 31 years after Tagore's visit, and we said this is the third Bengali anyway, Professor Ashok Chakladar is known to be the first Bengali to move to Vancouver. He joined UBC in 1960, and his young family joined him shortly. This was the beginning of Bengali settlement in BC, Bengali for India settlement in BC. In 1962, when Canada changed its immigration policy a bit, it raised interest in Bengalis who were already in Europe and USA to immigrate to Canada. What I heard was that getting visa from Europe was very easy. They just walked in and was given visa and sometimes even travel expense and tickets. This chart shows the year of arrival, the group of people that I talked to. You can see the 1970s, there's an increase in number. That is basically mainly because the 60s, the bachelors who came, they went back to India and got married and got their wives. But 1970s, late 1970s was the first time there was a registered Bengali Cultural Society was formed, which is known as Lower Mainland Bengali Cultural Society. I'm very sad that they didn't join this conference, but I have served as their president for three terms. In 1980s and 90s, you can see community did not grow much, and probably it is related to the slow economy of BC around that time. And again, in the 90s and later in 2000s, with the increase of software industry, we see little bit increase in population. I noticed several changes that took place in this diaspora over the 50 years period. I will mention a couple of them. Every Bengali who came in 1960s and some in 1970s said that they never planned to stay in Canada permanently and thought that they would go back. Some of them did go back, but later returned in a couple of years. Bengali, from the 80s onwards, did not mention any such plan. Communication with India changed significantly during this period. In the 60s, 70s, and 80s, handwritten letters were the only way to communicate. It took about 10 to 15 days to reach there or arrive there. And if Canada Post went on strike, then that was it. But now, communication is almost real time with WhatsApp, FaceTime, Google Hangout, etc. Another significant change was the migration of women. Mostly, women followed their husbands to Canada, but in this small group of people, the first 10 years of the new millennium, we find that women who were trained highly in technological field chose to come to Vancouver, and although they were married, their career was given important, same important as their husband's career when they were in the decision-making process that they are going to immigrate to Canada. And some of these women secured jobs first and their husband followed. And the biggest, this was the first group, the first 10 years of the new millennium, and among that group, this was the first time someone chose Canada for its same-sex marriage policy. The Bengali community, the group that I talked to, was a cluster of highly educated people. Among the 59 participants, there were 17 PhDs, all but one was obtained outside of India. Similarly, most of the master's degrees were received outside of India. On the other hand, engineers and doctors, they were fully trained in India. Now let's see how it relates to their employment. Finding employment did not pose a problem for this group of people. They found employment within weeks of their arrival, if not sooner. Some arrived with their job, a job offer. 62% are employed in their field of training. 25% said that they are underemployed as their credentials from India were not recognized. It is unfortunate that in that 25%, all but two were women. These women are highly educated. Some of them are highly educated from India, but when they came here, they didn't pursue or upgrade. And they are quite satisfied with their job. They don't see it as career. They see it as an engagement. Needless to say, their husbands have pushy jobs. Oh. All the Bengalis that I talked to, they were able to own and purchase their own home within 1 year to 4 years maximum. At the end of the conversation, I asked them about their connections with religion and language. 28 out of 31 men said that they did not practice any religious ritual and religion did not play a role in their lives. So this is these are from India, and I realized that all of them were Hindus. Three men said that they are involved with spiritual group and practices meditation and Vedantas, and all three were scientists. Women too said that religion didn't play a big role. However, all practiced few rituals every day in their home, and they all had a small shrine at home. But when it came to their mother tongue, Bangla or Bengali, all participants expressed their strong emotional connection with it. Other than few Bengalis, they were married to learn Bengali. Bangla is the language spoken at home. And what Tanya says, their identity, they said that Amra Mone Pali family, their Bengali is their heart. So they define their identity with their language, not their religion. This group of people are very comfortable with their Canadian identity and did not feel marginalized or acknowledged that there is racism and discrimination in Canada, but none said that they had experienced it directly. Just few anecdotes here and there. But I think this is another area of research that needs to be done. Why people do not say that they have suffered racism. They were aware of the First Nations people's plight, and some of them said that they tried to study about them while they were in India. Becoming aware of the residential school, the history of residential school, it is recently, one said, how come in our schools we don't learn one of the First Nations language? Bengalis who came in 1960s are octogenarians now. Their emotional attachment to Canada is still there because it is the home of their children and grandchildren. They do not regret the decision to come to Canada and do not think of going back to India. But I would like to share these two quotes with you, which I think are very poignant and say volumes. This was in response to my question whether they longed for their home and family in India. One said that once my parents and other relatives started to die one by one of old age, the space that I knew as my home was no more. And the second participant called me the next day and said, though I do not want to return back to India to live there anymore, it is my wish that after my death and cremation, my ashes be immersed to the River Mahananda. This was a river that runs through the city that this participant grew up in. So I do not know what shape the Bengali community will take for 50 years from now, 150 years from now, but at present it seems like this group of people, highly educated, talented, conscious group of people, and I think Bhadraluk. And but I think enriched the Indian society. These are my references.